So we're sticking with our UX track. And let's see here. In fact, that's going to be a very big focus of our next talk. So I think I'm sort of the perspective, and I think you all agree that UX has a long way to go in crypto. You know, there's a lot of analogies with, you know, between like crypto and the rise of the internet. Is it 1994? Is it 1988? I would like, in terms of UX, one interesting way to think about it is, you know, for those of you who are around for the days of like 1200 baud modems, you know, you could connect to not really the internet, but you could connect to other computers back then. It was quite clunky, all done in sort of a primitive CLI form. That evolved, of course, into AOL and Prodigy, and that's where things really started to get more more doable. You could connect to things. I think that's kind of where we are now. The mainstream is coming. People are getting involved that aren't crypto native. My mom, who's watching, hi mom, she's getting into crypto. She's been learning about NFTs this weekend and cross-chain bridges and all this stuff. And it's fascinating to see the mainstream coming. So we could probably all agree that crypto, it doesn't have the greatest UI UX right now. You've ever underpriced a gas transaction on ETH, you know, something like that. It sucks. However, our next panelists have a ton of insights on how things may improve. A lot of great thinkers in this space. So if you guys are all queued up, I'll hand it over to the panel.
Thanks, Kent. And thanks, everybody, for tuning in. I am thrilled to be here. Welcome, everybody, to Broke AF, Crypto UX is Bad and Getting Better. I'm the host, Zach. We've got Jill, Georgia, Lily, and Yalda as the panelists to discuss. As a heads up, this is a 30-minute panel, which is tight for four people to really dive into such a deep topic. So I've put together a deck with some of the thoughts that they've shared prior to the panel. I'll be dropping that link in the chat near the end, as well as social links, so you can follow everyone here in the discussion. So in the interest of getting right to it, I'm just going to introduce our panelists, and we can kind of jump in. So first off, we've got Georgia. Hi, Georgia.
Hello, lovely to be here. It's an absolute delight.
Oh, so glad to have you. Georgia, I actually worked with her at Consensus. She's an amazing researcher, currently freelancer. So I would definitely check her out. She's G_Rack on Twitter. Lily, hi.
Hey. Hi. Happy to be here.
So glad to have you. So she's a full stack designer specializing in fintech and decentralized applications currently at Pull Together. Yalda, project lead at Black Sky. Hi, I think this is the coolest JD I've seen at ETH Denver so far. It's a dystopian minimization engine is what Black Sky is. Great to have you. And then finally, Jill Carlson. I think Jill's probably the reason we're all here because of a tweet that you sent out in January. You've been investing in early stage startups at Slow Ventures. You researched closed economies with the Open Money Initiative at Jill Ruth Carlson on Twitter. Jill, so glad to have you.
Yeah, great to be here. Thank you. And glad I could play a small role in kicking off the discussion.
Well, I mean, and I think that's probably where we want to start, right? Like, so January 24th, I'll just read the tweet really quickly. And then I would love to actually kind of like start diving into, I think, what experiences spurred this. But you, in January 24th, you said crypto UX is entirely and utterly broken. If you're actually using it, parentheses, not via third party, it is borderline unusable. Even those of us who have been doing it for a better part of a decade. And then follow up tweet, I'm not convinced that it's fixable. I like both of those because I strongly agree, but I would love to understand a little bit better, like kind of like what the inciting incident was and kind of expand on those thoughts.
Okay, so look, without sharing sort of too much and you know, doxing myself in problematic ways or exposing myself to security vulnerabilities, which the very fact that I have to give that disclaimer already to me is, you know, drawing a line of, okay, this is maybe not ready for the mainstream yet. But that weekend, it was, I think, a Saturday or Sunday that I tweeted that out. And it was a moment of just sort of pure anguish and frustration, because that weekend I had been going through and basically doing kind of a self audit of, okay, like, where are my various crypto holdings? You know, what happened to this token that I got airdropped like 2 years ago? Where is that being held now? Going through the stuff that I had in various like DeFi protocols, et cetera. And it was, you know, there was nothing really spurring this other than I like to do this a couple times a year to make sure that I still know where everything is, how much it's all worth, and that I can still access it. And it took me about 2 days to do this. And, you know, my family members, my partners were walking into the room being like, what is going on in here? As I had sort of multiple laptops open, you know, making runs out to the bank, like various slips of paper around. And it was just this kind of comical thing of like, this is absurd. And I had to agree, you know, this was not, it didn't feel like the future of finance as I was going through all of this. And so, you know, when I said, I'm not sure that this is fixable, that specifically has to do for me with key management. You know, if you want to be self-custodying, which so many of us in crypto sort of pride ourselves on, then, you know, you have to figure out a protocol for yourself to custody your keys securely. And that is devilishly hard, can become uncomfortably high stakes. And that's the thing that I'm not sure is fixable. I think that, you know, the rest of sort of the UX leaps and bounds forward that we've seen over the last years have been commendable indeed. And I don't want to detract or draw away from those. But that was the moment of frustration that led to that post.
And so I want to ask about a clarification specifically in relation, because Lily, you actually responded to this thread. I was going back through it. Yeah. And so when you say parentheses, not third parties, are you saying like just kind of like interacting with the primitives in general? And then Lily, I'd love for you to kind of jump in and sort of like talk about sort of how you started thinking through sort of that statement.
Go ahead, Lily. Please take it away.
Okay. So first, I also have to say that I totally like agree that it somehow could be better, right? But then I think we are now arriving at some sort of like a new paradigm here. So we should not just really just compare like what we have right now with Web 2, right? I mean, if any of you like older than 30, probably you do remember the time when you hear the sound of modem, like 56K modem, like, you know, creaking. and it's kind of fine, right? I mean, like we actually kind of fixed that. We improved that from that point. And I also think so that in crypto, it will also be like that once we have more adoption and it's not the other way around. On the other hand, I think like the purpose that we are all here, most of the cases also dealing with money, is dealing with finance. And so for me, like adding friction to the flow is actually the new black now. I think it's good to kind of slow user down a little bit, basically. I know it's like leading to like a lot of frustration afterwards. And of course we could improve on that point, but I think it's also, definitely a good practice to simply just, you know, kind of make it a bit more difficult so people can stop and think and not just like keep clicking until at the end they were like, oh, actually I just gave like this permission that I didn't intend to. So I'm convinced that it will be able to improve. Maybe we do not really have to fix it if we do not, you know, like compare it with Web 2, I think.
I totally agree. There's like a concept of healthy friction. I think in the Web 2 space, especially as we've talked about friction, we almost see it as like a negative. And I think that's kind of how we've gotten into the current paradigm within Web 2. I want to touch on two things, Lily, that you said. Yalda, especially, so you, I asked for like some thoughts beforehand. You were kind of talking about not building with privacy in mind. And I feel like Jill kind of prefacing everything with like, I'm not interested in doxing myself, as like kind of key to like what you were talking about previously. Privacy to me is like one of the biggest problems, both in doing the proper research, but also in kind of a lack of privacy on the apps themselves. Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I think that, like, as I said in the note, this is a problem that's being largely ignored in the Ethereum ecosystem whenever it comes to application developers. It's like, yeah, there are some teams that are working on trying to enable us more, and there are, you know, challenges at the protocol level, but the fact that we're just building in this, like, oh yeah, just like use all these apps, and then users are getting into the system and you're not even like teaching them about, oh, if you deposit money into this account and then you transfer it to all these other accounts, everything's going to be linked together. So it's just like, we're inviting mass adoption into this system that exposes people in ways that traditional Web 2 doesn't. And I think that that's really bad. So I would like slow down from wanting mass adoption until we really think about the privacy issue, because it's a, I'd say it's like a big red flag that needs a lot more attention, and it is a user experience problem.
Like, with a ton of unexpected consequences, I think, as well. Georgia, I know you've actually done some research. A, like, both the research of having to do research on users while respecting their privacy, as well as, like, how people think about privacy in terms of crypto networks. Do you, I mean, you want to just jump in, or?
Yeah, it's interesting. So, yeah, I run user research. I help teams understand their users, who they're building these products for. And very often, teams don't really have a clear idea of who that is. And we talk about banking the unbanked, and, you know, subsecting people as crypto and non-crypto people. We're a really long way from servicing non-crypto people currently with the user experience that exists. So that, you know, that also comes down to privacy. So who is privacy important for? And are we building the products for those people? I think sometimes we have a really simplistic view of what user experience is in this space. So I've heard people talk about, well, teams talk about, we don't do UX, you know, but we're building an API and a service or something like that, right? But the reality is that every single touch point that a user has with your service, how they feel before and after it, what they do after as well, is all part of the user experience. The problem we have is that very often we're not thinking about who exactly is going to be using this product. So we may be thinking, well, you know, we the user is somebody who is really privacy focused, but is our product actually catering for that? Or we built a privacy service, but the people who need it can't get onto this service because of the learning curve, the blockers to adoption that currently exist. I do a lot of research with people who are traders, DeFi users, and people really care about their anonymity. So it can be difficult to get interviews with people, but generally people want their voices to be heard. I try and respect their anonymity as much as possible by allowing them to join, you know, a call that's just audio, not recording their call. I'm running a study like that currently for a big DEX to talk to high value traders. Those are people who do fiercely want to protect their anonymity. But also, how are we going to build good products for these people if we don't interview them, find out what they need, what their problems are, and what gaps there are in the market for products to serve those needs.
I guess a panel to everyone, is, would you, like, if we were to prioritize kind of like the biggest problems within crypto UX, would it be key management, maybe identity kind of as an umbrella term, and then privacy under that? Or are there any more pressing concerns that I think dApp developers should be aware of?
Can I have a diagram? Oops.
Go on, jump in first. Go on, Lily.
Okay, I'm just going to be very quick. I think key management is definitely one of the biggest problem, but it's also, I mean, if we talk about UX of it in itself, right? I think it's already kind of like bad UX since the way how it's being designed, right? Because usually the mnemonic seed phrase is using the system of like BIP39, which is having, I think, about 2048, something like these words in the collision, right? And it's usually going from left to right using English words. And I mean, this is not in any way international, because there's so many languages, which is like right from right to left, for example, right? And not using English, not using like Latin letters. Like, I mean, this is already kind of like, when you really think deeper about this, this is already, it's not very accessible. Yeah, but then, you know, I mean, there are a lot of things to be fixed. And I mean, this thing, I guess, like, it's probably going to be the last thing because it's kind of like usable. But then I think definitely how to recover it, it's the big problem of like most users.
Yeah, I would agree. So yeah, that you've got the seed phrase and why does that exist? It's a protocol layer decision, right? A design decision essentially on how the system's meant to work. So there we have the problem, right? Why is UX in crypto really hard? It's because some of the decisions that affect users have been made well before a user was imagined, right? Well before. And how do we overcome that? We need to bring this human design much earlier in the process for the things that we continue to build further on. I would say, controversially, another big problem for UX in the space is money. So unlike a traditional product that might raise funds off the back of a successful product, like we think of something Web2, they've demonstrated an audience, they've got users, that's how you then get investments, and then you might one day IPO or, you know, sell the company or something like that. With ICOs, IEOs, the money comes first. So where's the motivation to make something that's super usable, useful, serves a goal for users? It's much easier to create something, clone an existing project, spin it up, make loads of money. But this is only serving like a really small subset, even of crypto users, right? Let's talk about yield farming is a massive craze. All the energy is going into this because that's where the money is, but that's not where the best use is. And I'd love to see us really taking the more challenging problem that exists and building for those people.
I just want to touch on something that George and Lily both just said, which is that design has to start at the protocol layer. I so appreciate that, because I think to make kind of a meta statement about where the problem lies with design is that crypto as an industry is so good at optimizing. We are so good at taking something that exists and saying, oh, we can do this better. You know, we look at Ethereum and we say, oh, we can decrease latency or we can add privacy. But very seldom in that initial stage of ideation does the question return to the end user and ask the question, what does the end user want out of this protocol? And so I think that that's just really worth emphasizing. And I thank them for that point.
Yeah. And it's like, what should we build? Not just can we build it, right? We have to ask the difficult questions.
I also want to call out, I think is really interesting, Jill, the idea of iteration and optimization, which I think is really interesting because if you look at a lot of the broken systems that we're trying to replace, those are all around systems that were built with very narrow use cases in mind that were then kind of broadened out in order to like make do with the rest of the population, right? And so I think we're actually in danger of kind of replicating some of the same problems in Web2 and kind of traditional finance markets if we don't take this like very like broad approach when talking to people. Yalda, I'd actually, since you're kind of in the whole idea of dystopian mitigation, I would kind of be curious to hear from you as far as like what does that even look like to make sure that like you're essentially red teaming some of these really interesting crypto primitives.
What does which part look like?
How do you think about like talking to people and studying a problem from the perspective of like, how can this not be evil? Or how do we kind of mitigate kind of like the worst outcomes, I guess?
I mean, I think that basically we need to take things a lot slower and really critically think through all the decisions we're making whenever it comes to ownership of a protocol, governance of a protocol. I think a lot of projects are moving too fast and not really actually fully thinking of the implications of what is the longer term trajectory of all this like yield farming. Are these systems actually going to be the new financial systems, or is it just some fun game for now, you know? So I think that that there's just a lot of like, we can get like really lost in this like greed and just making a lot of money that you lose the focus of why you were building things in the first place. So I think just slowing down and mapping things out more and understanding how each decision is going to impact other parts of the system. So I guess thinking more like researchers as opposed to like a traditional business that's competing in the market, and then you just let the market decide the best winner, which might not necessarily be what is the best, what a lot of us wanted getting into cryptocurrency. So I think that that's going to be this divergence that's always existing in Ethereum or in blockchain, as the more ideologically aligned people, and then the more business-minded people, and those don't always fully fit together. So I think that whenever it comes to a protocol, there's more ideology baked into that protocol, or that protocol allows that some sort of ideology to flourish, and then an ecosystem forms around that, and then businesses are formed that kind of conform or align with that ideology. So I think that there is not really a consistent one. I don't see that in Ethereum. And I don't know if that's the best approach, but it might be if the protocol isn't going to be ideological, you might kind of have at least sub factions of the community that are maybe trying to realign with some of the original vision of crypto, so it doesn't get completely overtaken.
That totally makes sense. I want to be mindful of our time. Unfortunately, like I said, 30 minutes with so many brilliant people, 30 minutes is not a ton of time to actually dive in. I think kind of generally for everyone though, if let's say that we have a lot of companies, a lot of dApp developers, a lot of people thinking about how to begin approaching fixing kind of their broken UX around their work. Jill, first off for you, because I know you're investing, that means you talk to a ton of companies at almost like a 10,000 foot view. How are companies thinking about this, or crypto projects thinking about this? And then I'd love to hear from the others as far as just how companies can begin kind of incorporating research and that into it.
Yeah, well, what's fantastic is I'm seeing more and more companies, and most of the companies in the crypto space that I work with, now engaging product design researchers, experts in human-centered design, the likes of the people on this call, again, whose work I'm so grateful for, from the outset, before they even ship a test net, that kind of thing. Often what they're finding is that the issues lie in dependencies of things that they're working from or building from. And so that's kind of a larger discussion. But it is very heartening to see so many brilliant design minds coming into the space, and all of them getting picked up and engaged by these companies, for sure.
That's great.
I'll jump in and say, as it is, the phrase, do your own research. So it's super, super important to go and talk, have conversations with who you imagine your end user to be. I'm really delighted that I'm happy to say I'm extremely busy, which shows that there is a demand. But doing any user research, design research, is a competitive advantage in this space, because we have a lack of data about users. We know everything about on-chain transactions, but why do people do the things they do? What are their experiences when they do it? You can learn a lot from talking to just a small number of users. I really recommend the teams who are building now to improve their user experience, do this straight away. The best time to do research was yesterday, but if you can't do it yesterday, do it now. You can chat to me on Twitter and I can give you some tips on how to approach doing that. But you will learn a lot from just a small number of people that can help steer your boat in the right direction and essentially lead to adoption and retention. We're trying to keep users, not just get them to try out our protocol for once and then leave too. So it's thinking about longevity of projects, and it will motivate everybody on the team around the problem. Like, who are we doing this for and why?
Cool. Okay. So I jump in. So I'm like totally in line, agree with Georgia. I think we need more research in the space. But it's also another challenge, right? Because like, how can we do research without compromising user privacy? There are obviously a lot of data, behavior, interaction that, you know, we couldn't cache on chain. That would be very, very helpful. But meanwhile, and of course, in the future as well, I would hope that crypto UX would be bold. We have to be bold, but then we also be empathetic. So that would be the best case.
I love it. So we've got 5 minutes left. I think in closing, any high-level takeaways? I'd love for you to give you all just kind of a chance to kind of, I guess, like pitch what you're working on. Where can people follow? I'm seeing in the chat, people are already, Yalda, people are asking if you've got a newsletter. Hopefully you do. Yeah, there we go. Does Yalda have a newsletter or blog? Last 5 minutes, why don't y'all kind of just give us where we can kind of follow your thoughts and continue to sort of look into this and continue to fix UX in crypto. Yalda, why don't you start?
I'm, I guess, working on writing more in a blog, but I haven't fully published everything yet. But it will most likely be on blacksky.network. So you can go to that website. And it's like a rebrand of this previous project I was working on called Space Decentral. So it's called Black Sky now. And the other opinion I wanted to add as far as the user research is, I think that we actually need to do user research from dApp developers, not users of dApps. Like at a protocol level user research, the users are the developers in a large part. And, you know, a lot of the developers, they came into this ecosystem with a particular vision of what Ethereum should be. So I think aligning things around that and helping it go in the right direction would be very helpful. And that's another project I'm working on as far as what some of that, you know, user research could be is in Moloch DAO, which is a DAO in the Ethereum ecosystem. And there will be more information announced probably next week about these new initiatives within Moloch DAO. But we want to do this sort of like more deeper insights, like research from the Ethereum community when it comes to UX and privacy. So if you want to get more involved, I would say, you know, follow the Moloch DAO Twitter and you can get more involved with helping Ethereum in that way.
Excellent. Georgia, why don't you go next?
Yeah, thanks. I've already plugged myself. You can see there, G_Rack on Twitter. But I may as well just talk about just a couple of projects which I'm working on, which I think are great great examples of doing research well. To Yalda's point as well, I do often do research into the developer experience. That's so important. Like these are users, especially as a lot of teams are building products for other developers. Somebody likes to call it the D2D or B2D exchange. I'm working for a couple of projects at the minute. One trying to help audiences who don't have crypto get into crypto. Yes, there's a company trying to solve that problem. And lots of other more native crypto projects, which is super exciting. And one thing I would just advise teams who are watching this, who are building, is think about your copy. Every time I do user testing, the thing that just drives people nuts is the copy. Like, use simple language, try and make it easy for them to understand, and that will build confidence for them.
I love it. Lulu, why don't you, and then Jill, we'll close out on your props.
All right. So currently I'm working for Pool Together, and we have launched like so many new cool stuff. So just go check out. And fun fact is that a lot of users on Pool Together are those who like quite new to crypto as well. So I think it's kind of like a good onboarding platform to be in, right? Because it's not that complicated, but then yet it's still you are in DeFi like properly. So yeah.
Love it. Pool Together, I think, was the first dApp I used that felt like an app, which was
really
awesome.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah, it was so great. Yeah. So kudos to that. Definitely check out Pool Together if you haven't. Jill, let's close with you.
Huge fan of Pool Together myself. I work on a project called the Open Money Initiative. You can find us at openmoneyinitiative.org. Related to the last panel, which was about Celo and the work that they're doing, we look at closed economies, places like Venezuela, Cuba, Nigeria, even Argentina to a degree, even sometimes here in the United States, and examine how people access financial systems when they're not really built for them. So that applies more broadly, but of course, crypto plays a big role in that. I also frequently rant and rave in a column on CoinDesk, and so you can find more of my thoughts there as well. But thanks so much for having me, and thank you again to the rest of the panel. I'm just a lowly investor. You all are actually on the front lines of this, doing the work, so thank you.
Thank you so much. And thanks everybody for listening. Again, I've posted in the chat, I've posted the slide deck so you can find everybody as well as thoughts that they've provided beforehand. I think they're really, really useful. So go ahead and read those as well. I just to self-pitch, I've got a flash talk coming up, I think in maybe 45 minutes, In Search of the Mythical DApp User. We'll be talking about user acquisition. So be sure to check that out. And as always, thank you so much to ETH Denver for putting this panel on. I really appreciate the UX driven and kind of focus that ETH Denver has continued to have. So thanks so much.
You're welcome, Zach. And thanks to the entire panel. The feeling I have after listening to this is one of optimism. These are some daunting challenges we're up against, but there are a lot of really smart people thinking about these problems. It's not like, you know, this thing is going to jump up and bite us in the ass. Like, oh God, we didn't think about these problems. Like, you get the sense of almost inevitability that it's going to get worked out. The only thing is the details, and the future is looking bright. So thank you very much.